Good morning, Crossbridge Church. Thank you so much for joining us this Sunday morning. In a moment, we're going to get started, but before we do that, we want to thank you so much for tuning in to our online service. We are so happy that you're here. We have a few announcements starting off that we have some house parties coming up. If you want to see the dates for that, go ahead and download our app if you haven't already. It's available on the App Store. All you have to do is look up Crossbridge Miami Springs and there you'll be able to access our app. Also today, we're continuing our Roman series and we're going to hear from Pastor Sam in just a moment. But church, let us pray before we begin. Father God, thank you so much for this day, Lord. Thank you because you are our Father, you are our Savior, and you are our healer today. Lord, I pray that we may receive from the word that Pastor Sam is about to bring. And Lord, let it touch our hearts and let it be with us for the rest of our lives, Father God, that your word may carry on no matter what. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Church, let us worship together.
I'm forgiven the sin. came from heaven's throne. Acquainted with our sorrow, to train the debt we owe. Your suffering for our freedom. The bar of sin undone, the cross for my salvation, the Lamb of God in my place, your blood poured out my sin, erased it was my death.
Thomas Gallaudet graduated seminary in the early 1800s. He believed he had a calling to be a preacher, but this calling took a different twist and turn when he met a 9-year-old hearing-impaired girl in his neighborhood. He began communicating with her, teaching her words with nothing but a stick in the dirt, and helping her motivated him to help others like her as well. He eventually established the American School for the Deaf. He refined a system we know today as signing. Of course, his school included Christian curriculum, biblical instruction, teaching the gospel. He had answered the call that he felt God was calling him to do, but it was to a very specific people group, and signing was a way that he communicated the gospel to them. You know, I wonder how many of us may God be calling to reach unreached people groups with the gospel, and in what ways we can do that. Well, if you're joining us for the first time today, we're in episode 11 of our summer series based on the book of Romans, and today, hopefully, we'll learn why the greatest privilege we have as Christians is extending the gospel and extending it in a way that people can understand. And so if you have your Bibles, turn with me to Romans chapter 10. I'll be reading from verses 11 through 21. Here's what God's word says to us today. For the scripture says, everyone who believes in him will not be put to shame. For there is no distinction between Jew and Greek, for the same Lord is Lord of all, bestowing his riches on all who call on him. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. How then will they call on him in whom they have not believed? And how are they to believe in whom of whom they have never heard? And how are they to hear without someone preaching? And how are they to preach unless they are sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who preach the good news. But they have not all obeyed the gospel. For Isaiah says, Lord, who has believed what he has heard from us? So faith comes from hearing, and hearing through the word of Christ. But I ask, have they not heard? Indeed, they have. For their voice has gone out to all the earth, and their words to the ends of the world. But I ask, did Israel not understand? First Moses says, I will make you jealous of those who are not a nation. With a foolish nation, I will make you angry. Then Isaiah is so bold as to say, I have been found by those who did not seek me. I have shown myself to those who did not ask for me. But for Israel, or of Israel, he says, all day long, I have held out my hands to a disobedient and contrary people. You know, here Paul is continuing to underline again the unbelief of Israel as the reason that they're not enjoying the blessings of their salvation. The reasons that they're not enjoying the joy of their salvation. Somebody here might argue that the reason that these people are not believing in the gospel is because they don't have everything that they need to have to be held accountable for not believing. And so Paul here is removing that argument, and he's showing us the steps in being saved, not just that applies to Jews, but applies to everyone. He brings Isaiah 53 to witness. He says, very few are believing the gospel that he is preaching. He brings in here Isaiah 65, where he says that God's holding out his hands all day long to a disobedient people. And this is important for us to understand, because it's important for us to understand how our children come to faith, how our parents come to faith, how our brothers and sisters and neighbors and colleagues come to faith, or all of the unreached peoples of the world, how they are actually saved. And the process of coming to faith and coming to salvation is laid out here in this text like nowhere else in the Bible. And he gives us three steps here. First, the bringers of good news. In verse 15, he quotes from Isaiah yet again. And he says, how beautiful are the feet of those who preach the good news. Whenever we come to faith, and we come to faith God's way, there are some amazing promises that we have, some of which I'm gonna delineate here. We have assurance. In verse 11, he tells us we're never going to be put to shame. We have this assurance that part of God's plan is that we're never going to come to God and never going to hear him say, I'm sorry, I can't save you. No, instead, we're going to come to God one day and hear him say, good job, well done, good and faithful servant. We have this assurance reminding us that nobody who places their trust and their belief and their faith in Jesus for the salvation of their own souls will never need to be afraid of losing it or being ashamed when we face him in the next life. And let's face it, a lot of us got a closet full of reasons to be ashamed. Like, imagine if we were out, you know, there, and every time we thought of something, it was just broadcast to everyone, or every time we would think of something, it would just automatically update, you know, on our Instagram feed or Facebook page. A lot of us would be embarrassed, but here we have a God whom before all things are open and laid bare, our every thought. Here's the good news, that on the cross, Jesus bore our condemnation. He bore our guilt and our shame. We have assurance. Not just that, we have acceptance. He says here in verse 12, God doesn't play favorites. Even though there are places in the world right now where we will never be accepted, that is not the case. Anyone who hears God's call, anyone who responds in faith to Him will be accepted by Him. We have assurance, we have acceptance, we have amnesty. I know that might be a trigger word for some of us, but I love alliteration, so bear with me. We have amnesty. We have a divine amnesty. We are accepted by God. We have come to faith in Him, right? We will be saved when we call out to Him. And when we call out to Him, doesn't mean call out to Him in our way, but it means calling out to Him in His way. Not on our terms, but on His. To seek God in the way that He has prescribed. So whenever you hear somebody say, yeah, you know, me and God, we got this arrangement. No, they probably don't. God has prescribed a way that we call out to Him. We are granted eternal, divine amnesty and will never be brought into judgment for our sins ever again. Now, how in the world did we ever learn about these promises? How did we discover these promises? How did we learn about this? Well, Paul wants us to know that it may have ended up with us crying out to God, but it started all the way when God raised up a messenger to take the word of life to those who are lost. Now, you don't normally look at somebody's feet and think, you know, these leathery, stanky, scarred, nasty-looking feet, you know, wrinkled from all of this walking to remote places and think, wow, those are pretty amazing-looking feet. Nobody says that. Beautiful feet are, you know, pedicured, painted, and well-tanned. Those are beautiful feet. But the feet, right, of this person who brings good news could never be heard of any other way. People of whom the world is not worthy is beautiful because of the good news of good things that they bring. And probably the hardest people group to convince are good people, because bad people know they're bad and they know they need help. But good religious people, people who look at other people and say, you know what, compare myself to that Christian, I behave better, I do better, I'm a better person. For sure, I'm gonna be good when I stand before God, if there even is a God. These are the hardest group of people to convince of their need, because they're blind to their need. They don't understand that what they need and what other people need is the same thing. What everybody needs is to be reconciled to God. And the way that God has prescribed for us to call on Him is when we have nothing to offer Him but our sin. When we call out to God, God, we're not asking Him to give us some pointers. God, just give me one or two pointers so that I can be ready for the judgment. Be nice to know. We're calling out to God in the same way that the sinner calls out to God in Luke's gospel when he says this. He says, God, he beats his chest. He says, God, be merciful to me, the sinner. Here's a second step in coming to faith. Not just the bringer of good news, but also the hearers who understand. Verse 17, he says, faith comes from hearing, and hearing through the word of Christ. Preaching, or the act of preaching in the Greek, means to herald. A herald was somebody who stepped out, who was sent out under the authority of the king to bring a message. The herald couldn't tweak the message or adapt the message in a way that it would be more palatable to the hearer. The herald could be murdered by an angry mob, but he still had to convey the king's message, right? This is where we get the saying, don't shoot the messenger. When we go out and preach the gospel, we can never tweak the gospel in a way that our hearers may want to hear. We have to tell them that they have sinned against God, that all they deserve is God's displeasure. Why would we do that? So that they can learn that they need to be saved. We need to confront people's universal belief that they can save themselves. Why would we do that? So that they can not only look at their bad things, but also the good things that they do as a system of salvation and cry out to God to be saved. They got to know, right? And so God calls us to this. Now, this assumes that we're able to communicate in the language and in the culture of those that are listening to us. And communication also means that we're not compromising the message in an attempt to be offensive. We don't need to offend people. Listen, the message of the cross is already offensive. We're already confronting people with their sin, right? We don't need to throw the Bible at people in order to get their attention, although this is probably what Israel needed in this context. In Paul's day, the Gentiles were pouring into the kingdom by the hundreds, by the thousands. while the Jews were still refusing to believe. And it was confusing. Why would the Jews not believe this? They had so much light and still not come to God. They heard it, they knew it, and they still refused. And guess what? We still see that today. We still see this continuing and confusing rejection today. People come to our gatherings, they hear the gospel preached to them, and yet they still refuse to come to Jesus. They'll give intellectual assent as to who Jesus is. Jesus was a good guy. Yeah, I get it. They give intellectual assent, but they don't call on him for salvation. They won't call on Jesus to receive his righteousness. They won't call on Jesus in order for him to fill them with his love, to fill them with his mercy. And that can be discouraging for us, the messengers. But church, we still need to go out and we still need to be faithful, because there's a lot of people who have never heard the gospel. We still got to continue to be faithful in getting this news to their ears. Like the old African proverb that says, the only thing that's worse than murder in the desert is to know where the water is and not tell people. We know where the water is. We have the greatest news in this whole universe. We've been granted the privilege to preach this. And so we got to tell everyone. We got to start locally first. We got to start praying for the salvation of those who we regularly come into contact with. Pray for opportunities to talk to them about Jesus. The hearers need to understand that saving faith includes a spiritual satisfaction for all that God is for us in Jesus. It's just not giving them information. It's not giving them the confidence that everything is going to work out in the end. But it's also giving them a spiritual sense that this good news is Christ himself, and that having him is better than life itself. Jesus would one day look at the Pharisees right between the eyes and listen to what he tells them in John's gospel. He says, "If God were your father, you would love me." He's telling the most religious, the most God-oriented, Old Testament-saturated people on the planet, you don't know God because you don't love me. And here's the litmus test on whether or not we love Jesus, is whether or not we're worthy of him, which doesn't mean deserving. It just means that when we realize we've been redeemed and we've been forgiven to be in his presence, when we are gripped by that reality, when we understand that reality, then our faith, we'll finally understand that our faith is not just fundamentally a decision of the will, but it's this deep, profound transformation that happens in what we treasure and what we love. We love Jesus above everything else. Here's the final step in coming to faith: the voice that we got to embrace. Last week, we saw Paul wrestling with how to understand, how to explain, how to feel about, how to respond to the unbelief and the lostness of God's chosen people, Israel. And this will be a burden for him all the way to the end of chapter 11. And the point here is that this unbelief was not owing to the absence of anything that was present or needed in order to be held responsible. It was not owing to any of that. This is the question in verse 18 that he asked. Have they not heard? In other words, have not the conditions been met? What conditions? The conditions of sending a preacher and listening to said preacher. And then he quotes from Psalms 19. He says, yeah, the conditions have been met. And he goes and asks another question, right? He asks another question in verses 19 and 20. What he's literally saying is that the Gentiles believing in Jesus and inheriting the promises made to Israel was something not only predicted by Moses, but it was also something predicted by the prophet Isaiah, which would have served or should have served as a megaphone to Israel that would have made the gospel or the message that Paul was preaching understandable to them. And yet what Paul ends this chapter is this picture of God calling, inviting, wooing through his prophets and his preachers, but the hearers don't believe. And therein lies the mystery that we got to embrace. What mystery? The mystery of God's sovereignty and our responsibility. Because on the one hand, people want to portray God, right, the sovereignty of God over our human will and say, you know what, this picture is wrong. It's wrong to show God this way, calling with his arms stretched out. He almost looks like he's begging people. And on the other hand, people want to portray the human will over God's sovereignty and say something like, you know what, look, if God is inviting and God is calling and God is wooing and he's begging, then it kind of really shows that he's not really in control of things here. But both of these perspectives in and of themselves are wrong. Because on the one hand, one group rejects something very precious and deep and profound that God has revealed about himself for our strength and for our hope and for our love. And the other group rejects something crucial in understanding the justice of God and dealing with people. And so they fail to see how we should plead with people and how we should invite people and how we should woo people even to tears to Jesus and on behalf of Jesus. On the one hand, God is the potter. And on the other hand, he also wants everybody to come to repentance and to the knowledge of the truth. And he's extending both hands. That's the picture we see here. Both hands all day long. To everybody, to everyone. Understand that speaking for Christ is not a human impulse. God blesses God sent messengers of the gospel, but be careful. Don't ever tell yourself, you know what? I don't believe I'm sent, so I'm just not going to say anything. No, but rather say, God, here I am. Send me. I'm right here. However you want to send me, send me. Send me to an unreached people group. Send me to the urban neighborhoods of my city. Send me across the street to my neighbors who need Jesus. Send me across the office. Send me to pick up my cell phone today and call somebody. Send me across my living room right now after I finish this online service. Send me. There is a divine voice that is calling us and that is sending us so that all of us have an opportunity to be bringers of the best news in the world. And if you have Jesus with you, you're eventually going to experience this. And when you experience this, what's going to happen is you're going to find people that they need to hear. They need to feel and they need to see the gospel. Name dropping Jesus isn't going to cut it anymore. People need to see, they need to feel that we need to embody the love of Christ instead of just correcting people's life choices. We need to embody the love of Jesus. We need to show them that they got a brighter future ahead of them, that a brighter future is possible, that there is a grace that runs deeper than their failures, that there is a grace that runs deeper than their afflictions or their addictions, that there is possibility that they can change, that they can transform from the inside out. Just presenting them with information about Jesus is not enough anymore. People need to know how Jesus' life and how Jesus' death is good news to them. Pastor and author and a good friend of mine, Jonathan Dodson, says it this way in his book. He says, a chorus of gospel voices is stronger and more compelling than a lone voice in the wind. We got to do this together, church. There are struggles, there are fears, there are hopes and dreams that lie on the surface of people's stories. And if we listen well with the dependence on the Holy Spirit, we can discern exactly what they need to hear the most. We can communicate a believable gospel. And so people searching for acceptance in all the wrong places, we can point to them to the gospel of justification. To people who are searching for fulfilling relationships, we can point them to profound personal union with Jesus. To people who are struggling with tolerance, we can show them the uniqueness that they have in Jesus in the gospel of redemption. To people who fear disapproval or people who are fighting for the approval of others, we can share the gospel of adoption, which, by the way, offers an enduring approval and produces a humble confidence. And for people who are looking for a fresh start, for people, maybe that's you today, who are looking for a clean slate, a fresh start, a new beginning, I'm going to preach the gospel to you, a gospel of a new creation. People need to know how the gospel is good news to them. And so, church, can we commit ourselves to loving people, loving them enough to offer them a believable gospel as messengers, as heralds, as bringers of the good news, and communicate, tell people that news in a way that they can understand. It is our greatest privilege. Amen? Would you pray with me? Heavenly Father, we thank you. We thank you for the people who told us about Jesus. Thank you for those that taught me in Sunday school that Jesus made all the difference. Thank you for those who mentored me into adulthood and showed me my need of salvation, which only comes through the sacrificial death of Christ on my behalf. Thank you for all who've proclaimed the gospel, the message of Jesus, the incarnate, quickening, living Word of God in my hearing. And Lord, may my feet and the feet of the people here listening today be feet that bring with them the beautiful message of peace with God by grace through faith in Christ Jesus, our Lord, in whose name I pray. Amen. And subscribe and follow this channel so you don't miss a single video or live stream. Go ahead and share this video with friends. And remember, you can join me in person every Sunday at 10 a.m. Thank you for watching.